good morning, everybody. Hope you've had a great Thanksgiving weekend, had a great time with family and friends, and so glad you're here to be a part of our service this morning. Pastor Alan and Janice, they're on vacation. They're seeing their kids in Iowa, so you know he's cold, but I'd be praying for them as they'll be traveling back this week. It's so good to have you here. In fact, this morning I'm going to be breaking the word to you this morning, and then Pastor Drew is going to be preaching tonight. So you have the assistant pastors coming in to bring in the heat, all right? So it's so good to have you here. Let's have a word of prayer as we continue on. Father, it has been such a blessing these past few days to be able to focus on Thanksgiving. I know for many of us, sitting around tables, being with family and friends, is so overwhelming of the blessing that you give. And Father, now as we have a time to be able to once again remember on how you've worked in our lives, Father, I pray today's message will be one to help us remember how you brought salvation to our souls and how you used others to bring us to Christ. Father, I pray that every part of this service is one that even though we've had a pretty busy weekend, that this would be a time that our souls are refreshed and recharged and really excited about what the future lies for us here at Bible Baptist Church, for the opportunities that are around us. Father, help us to be hungry for the word this morning. Help us to sing songs from a thankful heart. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our next song this morning will be 112 in your hymnals, God Leads Us Along. We'll sing all three verses today.
In shade and in pasture, so rich and so sweet, God leads us, your children, along. Where waters will flow, pace the weariness feet, God leads us, your children, along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood, some through great sorrow.
Be singing By the Gentle Waters.
By the Our scripture reading this morning is found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, we'll be reading verses 17 through 26. And it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with a palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said unto him, Man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, What reason ye in your hearts? Whether is easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise and take up thy couch and go into thine house. And immediately he rose up before them and took up that whereon he lay and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today.
I'd like to ask the men to come as we take our offering this morning, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, our hearts are encouraged as we listen to the accounts of you working in the lives of people. And Lord, we can even look back at our own lives, and we can see how you have done amazing things through salvation and in sending Jesus to die for our sins. And Lord, we are so thankful for that. We're so thankful as we've sung this morning that you have a plan and a purpose for our lives, and nothing happens by accident, and that you are working through the circumstances and the details of our lives to accomplish what you will for us. And so, Lord, we just thank you for that as well this morning. And as we come off of Thanksgiving and we look ahead to Christmas, I pray that our thankful hearts would continue and that we would be reminded of all that we have because of you sending Jesus to earth. Help us even during this time of the year as we have opportunity to talk with neighbors, talk with those within our community, possibly invite them out to a service or a cantata or a Christmas carol sing, that you would give us boldness to do that, and that we would take these opportunities during this Christmas season to point people back to Jesus. Lord, thank you that we also can support servants of yours that are faithfully serving around the world. And so this morning we want to pray for just a couple of those. We pray for Paul Rebert at First Baptist Church in Danville, Illinois. Thank you for his ministry there and the way that he impacts the church congregation. Thank you for that church family that is reaching the Danville area. And we pray for strength for them. We pray for opportunities over these next several weeks as they also invite their community out to special events that are taking place in their church. And I pray as the word of God is preached that you would bring souls to you. We also pray for the Jones as they serve in the Philippines. Thank you for their faithful ministry for many years. And we pray you continue to give them good health, good strength as they serve you. And I pray that you would continue to provide opportunities for them to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we take this offering, again, we're thankful for all that you have given to us. And we're reminded that we don't deserve any of this. And I pray that these resources that we give back to you would be used wisely as we seek to reach the Matthews community and also spread the gospel around the world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Verna. Our children through fifth grade are going to be dismissed during our next song. Please stand as we sing our hymn of the month, O Church Arise. This will be our last month, or last week of this song, O Church Arise. We'll sing all four verses today.
God incarnate in his Son.
Amen. Thank you, Bethany. Getting us ready for the Christmas season. As it's just around the corner now that Thanksgiving is over. Let's go ahead and take our Bibles. Keep your finger there in Luke chapter 5, where Rob was able to lead us in scripture reading there. And then also we'll be spending our time in Mark chapter 2. It is a story that is in the different Gospels in different perspectives. It's interesting as you look at Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it's how the Lord gave a perspective of these four individuals inspired by God, but helping us to see Jesus in a different lens. It reminds me of when I went to the principal's office in elementary school. He wanted some counsel, so I was going in to see him about an altercation with some friends, whatever. But I remember as I was in there, the principal just being in his office, fear came over my body. But then I looked at his desk, and on his desk, now this was back in the 70s, he had a cube on there. And in that cube, he had different pictures of he and his family, so you could spin that cube and see him in a different perspective. Like I thought he lived at the school, right? I thought the office was his home, and here he had children. I thought he ate children, but he had children, and it showed him smiling, and it kind of gave a different perspective. When we look in the Gospels, what we do is we are able to see Jesus in a different perspective. Matthew, as pastor, has been preaching on this series, and Matthew really is the point of view from a Jewish point of view. As you get to Luke being a doctor, a physician, he gives us amazing detail that you don't see in other Gospels. And in John, 92% of John is unique. In fact, it's not found in any of the other Gospels, but he gives us still a perspective of different stories. Mark was written to the Roman audience. In fact, Mark is one that's the shortest of the Gospels, and it is like an action-adventure theme. He doesn't spend a lot of time on teaching. He just motors through what Christ did. And so we're going to see the perspective of that in Mark chapter 2. Before we get there, I just wanted you to know this past week, Tuesday, Deb and I were coming into work. And we live in Monroe, came out of our neighborhood, turned right, and as we're going down, traffic is intense. We have a Sun Valley High School, we have an elementary school, we have a preschool on our road, and so the traffic is intense. And as we're driving along, as soon as we come out of our neighborhood, I'm driving down, and we have two churches that are across from each other. And this one church to our left has a very long driveway, and they have a mysterious building in the back that I've not been back there before because they chain off their driveway. What's that all about? So as I'm driving along, all of a sudden, I kind of just glanced to my left. I just kind of glanced, and I was like, I told Deb, I said, did I just see what I think I saw? There's no way. So I came over, I turned left into the preschool, navigated through their parking lot, came back towards our neighborhood and pulled into that driveway, trying to keep away from the chain. And I told Deb, I said, is that what I think it is? And it was a bald eagle was in the field snacking on something. And I'm looking at it thinking, is that what I think it is? And we were only like maybe 20 yards away. I couldn't get any closer. And in fact, if you looked over into a tree that had no leaves, there were three birds on one side, and then it looked like a sixth grader was sitting on the other side because it was the other eagle over there, and you could see the birds on the other side going, what's up? You're huge. All right, and so I'm looking at this, and I know you're thinking, did you get pictures? I took pictures, I took videos, but it's like whenever you're out and you see the moon, you're like, look how the moon is huge. I'm going to take a picture. And then when you look at it, it's like I spilled milk on my phone. It's just a dot. Well, it is small. I'll show you afterwards if you'd like to see it. I'll show it to you. And you're thinking, why didn't you get closer? Why didn't you get a selfie? I wanted to, but I couldn't get Deb out of the car, and I think she was afraid she'd get her shoes muddy, whatever. I would have waited for her. But we didn't get a selfie, but I did get this picture. But the thing that amazed me when I saw this is I thought there are going to be cars just parked along the side.
because it was a bald eagle in the field, huge bird. And he kind of looks at us. You know, I know he's looking at me. So he's looking at us, and he kind of does what he does. And I thought, well, surely, and I looked over on the side of the road, people just keep on going. Nobody's stopping. And I couldn't believe it. In fact, I thought, well, maybe there's, you know, maybe bald eagles are just, you know, the neighborhood bird. You know, maybe people see them so often, they just don't think anything about it. And so when I went to my barber, I talked to him. He goes, I know there's two eagles. They mentioned this river. Does anybody know the river? Okay, you need to go to my barber, all right? So he knows the river where these two eagles are, but I searched to say any in Monroe, Indian Trail, nothing. In fact, I was looking to see if did anybody see this on Tuesday of this last week? Nothing. I just couldn't believe it. I thought for sure we were going to have this pile of cars and people just jockeying for position on there to see this. Nothing. Well, that's not the case of the story we're going to look at this morning. In fact, if you have your Bibles there in Luke chapter 5, even as Rob started off with the scripture reading, in verse 17, it really kind of helps us set the tone of what's about ready to take place. Jesus is in his homeland. In fact, this is, some would say that Capernaum was his home. He's at Capernaum. In fact, in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 13, it really talks about that Jesus, being from Nazareth, he relocated to Capernaum. That's where some of the disciples were. Some believe maybe he was in Peter's house, which makes it interesting. But in here, you see that as he comes, in verse 17, it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting, which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present. Now let's go over to Mark chapter 2. I want you to keep in mind that Luke chapter 5 and verse 17. And then in Mark chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, it says, and again, he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. And straightway, that word straightway in the King James is one of the key words to the Gospel of Mark, means immediately. Immediately, many were gathered together, insomuch there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door, and he preached the word unto them. There were some that were there that were curious, some that were bright-eyed disciples hanging on every word, but what we see is there's a crowd. And one thing that's interesting about a crowd is a crowd attracts a greater crowd. In fact, it says when it was noised about, hey, Jesus is back in town, all of a sudden the house is immediately full. In fact, as they gather in there, it might be on the inside packed with people, but on the outside there was dust, noise, heat, disease, jostling, and crowding. In fact, in this passage, I want you to see the two dominating presences that are here. According to Luke, again, Luke 5:17, it says they were teachers of the law, Pharisees. They were from all over the place. They've been hearing about Jesus. They think they know about Jesus. And so they show up to this house. And in Luke chapter 5 and verse 17, it tells us they were sitting. If you and I had come in there, we might come in and go, oh, there must be a Bible conference going on here. This is incredible. Look at everybody that is in here. Look at these guys. Look, the scribes and the Pharisees, they're probably wanting to hear this. It's probably some spiritual life conference. But what was really going on was it was an investigative committee trying to find some dirt on Jesus. But you know, as we look at this, you see they're standing room only, and they were sitting as they were in these honored seats. They probably had suspicious looks, waiting for a slip-up. And unlike having that eagle in the field, in this room right now, there is fire in the air. People can feel the tension because in Luke 5:17, it says at the end of that verse, they have you can hear where it says, and the power of the Lord was there to heal. Because the other dominating presence that's in the room is Jesus. In fact, he's calm, unperturbed, in control. As you're in Mark, look at chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. Mark 1, 14 and 15, and after that, John was put in prison. Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Here is Jesus. He is preaching. He is bringing the message, but there is definitely tension in the air. The atmosphere is charged and it's starting to crackle, and the disturbance begins. Before we go any further, let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, help us now as we look at the matter of the word, as we've already had time in our service to sing, hear the scripture read, and a time of prayer for those that are serving elsewhere, and then also to take an offering of being able to give back on how you so richly blessed us. As we hear special music from the choir in Bethany, that thrills our heart, that challenges us of what we need to be doing and letting other people know the message of the gospel. Father, here we come to the word. And for some of us, it takes us back to junior church or Sunday school. I know this story. I've taught this story. But Father, you have something for us today. Help us as we look at the matter of faith. Help us to see the healing faith, but also understand the hindering faith that is here. Father, I pray you help me to use my time wisely. And I thank you for how you've been speaking to me. And Father, I pray that is just conveyed in the message this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So as you look here, we're going to look at the healing faith in verses 3 and 4. It says, and they came unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, paralyzed, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. Here comes this story of the healing faith. Here we see four men walking in the streets, and they're carrying a stretcher. And on that stretcher, they have a paralytic, prone, motionless friend. As they start to approach the house, no doubt the first few attempts to get in, can you imagine carrying their friend? We don't know how far they carried him. We don't know from where. Was he just down the street, or was he from another town? But his friends heard, Jesus is here, and we're going to take our friend. And as they're walking through carrying this stretcher, or born of four, they're walking up and they get down the street, and you can see they're looking at the house and it is just packed. People are on the outside. They're jostling, trying to get positions, trying to get in there to see him. And as they go, okay, let's try and get in. Hey, we've got a guy here. We want him to see Jesus. And they're like, you know what? Everybody wants to see Jesus. You know, get in line. I mean, it was worse than Black Friday, right? And it's like, get in line. It's going to happen. Just wait your turn. And they kind of take a step back, and maybe they set the mats down. They kind of mop their brow. They look at their friend, and they're looking at the crowd. And then they have this idea. And now, I don't know exactly how it happened, but we know as they got there, they couldn't get in, that all of a sudden they start to maybe look around. As they're looking at the homes, the way they're built at that time, it's not like ours where all the homes are separate many times. It'd be more like an apartment. They'd have a few homes that would be connected together, separate families living there, but yet they would use, you know, common walls for each other. But as you've seen the pictures at different times, they would have stairs on the outside that would lead up into the roof. And as they're standing there, all of a sudden maybe they look at the neighbor's house and they go, hey, there's stairs. Let's take him up on the roof. And can you imagine when they pick him up, they're already sweating, they're already straining, they get him up there and they start to go upstairs. Now, it's been Thanksgiving. You've probably had to get chairs from a different room. You probably maybe even had to carry some up or downstairs. While your mom is saying, don't touch the walls. You're trying to navigate getting that through there. Moving furniture through the house is not fun, needs to be done. You're trying to be careful. But can you imagine carrying your friend? And as they're going upstairs, they're trying to keep it level. They're trying to get him right where he needs to be. And they get up there, and maybe they get up there and they go just over here, and now they're standing on top of the house where Jesus was. Maybe they set him down, they catch their breath, they look at their friend, and they start to tear that roof up. Now, the way the roofs were built there in Bible times, and because you have phones, you could probably find it on a Bible dictionary, but from what I understand, they had timbers that were cross-cut, laid on there, and then they put branches and leaves, and they'd pile it on and about a foot, and then the last foot they would put dirt. They'd pack it down hard so that way nothing would leak through. And so, in fact, in the summer times, grass would grow on the roofs. And so when it comes to the matter of them, they might have had some maybe basic tools, but they started going right after this roof. And as they're starting to dig and starting to tear it away, and their friend is off to the side, watching his four friends dig this hole for him. As he starts to dig that, and you can start to hear maybe as they're inside, Jesus is preaching the gospel. You've got the cherished row of critics over here sitting there watching. You know, if he's saying something, they're probably nudging each other like, whatever, who's this guy? All of a sudden, they're like, what is that? What is going on? And Jesus is trying to teach, and they can hear maybe some shoveling up top. Some debris is starting to fall, and then all of a sudden a crack of sunlight comes in. Next thing you know, it's getting bigger, and they're starting to bring a body down. You can hear some loud conversations, and I can imagine there's some loud conversations. Can you imagine if this was Peter's house, what Peter's probably doing? You know, what are you doing? What are you doing? And the friends are up there, and they're starting to let him down, and they're probably saying, okay, make way. We're letting him down. We're letting him down. You guys watch out. Right there, as he's coming from above, that which is below, you see Pharisees that are covered with dirt going, what? This is my best robe. Unbelievable. And then in the midst, you see the prince and the paralytic. Right there, Jesus with this man. You know, as I was been studying this and kind of taking copious notes and reading different commentaries and just, again, letting the Lord speak to my soul about this, I wrote this down. God is going to work in a life because his friends really loved him. You know, it's interesting as he is there. We all know what happens next, right? I know you're not going, oh, what's going to happen? We know what happens. All right, he's going to be healed. So I want to concentrate on the four. As we're looking at this matter of healing faith, look at verse 5 at the beginning where it says this, when Jesus saw their faith. One thing we can say is we can see some great love and some great faith. In fact, their love is so great for this one that it didn't bother them. Where they're walking up there and people are going, hey, what are you doing? You're bumping me, man. You know, oh, really sorry. Maybe we should just stay over here and wait. Maybe Jesus will come out. No, that didn't bother them. They didn't care if they were being judged by, what are you taking the guy up on the roof for? They're not even concerned on the fact we are about ready to vandalize somebody's home. Is this legal? What they did is they had a friend they loved that they were getting him to Jesus. In fact, I thought, who is the friend? Who is this guy that they're carrying? Is he a relative? I mean, anytime I see in Scripture someone who is paralyzed, many times they're alone. This guy had four friends. And as they're taking him there, he is one that we don't know if he's a relative. Is he a neighbor? Was he a childhood friend? One thing we know about this guy is he was rich to have friends like this. There are those that spend millions of dollars to get loyalty from others. Here is a man who had nothing, but he had four friends that were determined, that cared about him, that wanted to get him to Jesus. We could stop right there, and there's many applications we can take on that. But I want us to look at the great faith that they had. Because with this extreme action and outrageous conduct, you knew they had to believe that Jesus could and would heal him. As they were getting ready to go, whatever it started, whenever they heard, hey, Jesus is in Capernaum, he's over, I think he's at Peter's house, that they're talking about, let's take Hezekiah. Let's take him, and maybe he's in the house, and they're always transporting because they love this guy. And maybe he's looking at him going, what are you talking about, what? Taking me where? When? Now? How? Cars aren't invented yet, all right? We can't do this. No, we're gonna carry you, we're gonna take you to Jesus. Now, some of you have some crazy friends, right? We all have some crazy friends. And when those friends get crazy ideas, you hope their crazy idea has to do with somebody else, all right? Not you. Well, all of a sudden these guys are talking, no, we're gonna do this, we're gonna take you over there to see Jesus. They believed that Jesus could heal. In fact, take your Bibles, go to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. And when we look at the matter of great faith, we're going to see an example of some great faith. But realize this. This is what is said about them. Hebrews 11 and verse 6. If you don't have it marked, you need to mark this one. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Because we know how this story ends. This right here are those four friends. Because as they're going, nothing ever stopped them. As they were taking him over there, it wasn't a matter of, man, Hezekiah, you are heavy. What did you eat? Okay, how far we got to go? Oh, this is going to take a while. Oh, look at the crowd. You know, Hezzy, I'm sorry. It's just not going to work. You know, I've got a condition. I got to work tomorrow. All right? It didn't stop them there. In fact, as they looked around, and I wonder who's the guy that said, let's go to the roof. That guy I want to meet. All right? Because somebody had the idea, let's get him to the roof. And as they would take him up to the roof and the strain to get up there, getting him up there and then thinking, let's punch a hole. Let's punch a hole in here. We will open this up and we will drop him down in there. And he said, Hezekiah, what did you drop? What do you mean by drop? We'll get you down in there to see Jesus. Because they understood who Jesus was and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So there's three aspects about their faith I want you to see, because their example of faith makes most of the power of God. And you and I together can be a team of four in many different ways in this place, and with those we love and with those that we're concerned about getting the gospel. One thing we see about this is they were persistent. Their faith was persistent. Back to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. Because as they were going along there, and it wasn't a matter that the crowd just kind of gathered up. It was, the Bible says the crowd, it just happened. Once he was noised, he was there, everybody's there, and all of a sudden it becomes persistent. There's no stopping them. There's a closed door, crowd's too big, you can't get in, other people are sick, sorry about your friend, you got to take a number, and they're like, okay, this is not stopping us. Look at Matthew chapter 11, Matthew chapter 11 and verse 12. It's interesting what it says about the followers of Jesus at this time. In Matthew 11 and verse 12, it says this, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. I love my Ryrie Study Bible. He says this, verse 12, since the time John began preaching, the response had been violent, whether by vicious opponents or enthusiastic supporters. I mean, we see the intensity of Jesus' enemies, but look at the enthusiasm of Jesus' followers. Look how they were working to get their friend there, and nothing was going to stop them. They were persistent. There is no other better story of persistence than this. Nothing stopped them. So the question came to me this week. What sometimes stops me? What keeps me sometimes from maybe sharing a word of testimony, a gospel invitation, a response to a message? Are there times that I need to go, well, you know what, if pastor says just the right phrase, you know, if we had an organ and it played just as I am, I would be down the aisle. That's what I need. I need a mood. Or I wish I had better responses from people. When I look at these guys and what they did in Mark chapter 2, and thinking of all the resistance they received, their faith was persistent. And when Jesus saw their faith, them just bringing their friend down in this hole in the roof, that phrase of Jesus saw their faith is just pregnant with meaning. Because in that, as he came down, he sees persistence. Also, number two, you can see creative. Use the word creative on their faith. You know, there's some, maybe they looked at this and they saw it and they go, why didn't I think of that? Why didn't I think of that? Some of you have probably picked up your phone going, why didn't I think about this? Pictures on your phone. Who would have knew, right? Oh, you know, a Happy Meal. What a great idea. Why didn't I think about that, right? Different things that we come in there and say, why didn't I think about that? Well, I'll tell you why nobody else thought about this. Because nobody else was as passionate about their belief in the Savior that Jesus can heal our friend. We just have to get him there. We just have to get him in the room. What is it going to take to get him in the room? And also, their love for their friend was something that didn't stop them. They were creative. I came across this phrase, faith that truly believes that Christ is the only way will be inventive. When I remember going to my father-in-law's office before he was my father-in-law, and he was a fire chief in Sterling Heights, and he had a really neat office there in the fire station, and I was going to ask him, you know, I wanted to ask him for Deb's hand in marriage, and instead of saying, hey, let's go in the side room, he took me to his office, sat me down on the other side of his desk, and it was intimidating, but I was persistent, all right? One thing is, we got talking, and he finally said yes after I gave him a lot of money. After he said yes, all of a sudden, I came around his desk, and behind his nameplate, where it has, you know, Ken Durham, fire chief, on the back of his nameplate, it had this phrase, desire breeds creativity. Desire breeds creativity. These guys had such a desire to get their friend to Jesus that nothing was going to stop them, and they came up with some creative ways to get their friend to Jesus. You know, I have enjoyed, as the Lord has called us here, we arrived in 2018, and the anniversary of my Sunday being here is appropriate. It's April 1st. Stop right there, okay? But the Saturday before our first Sunday, Pastor Allen was saying, hey, you ought to get here early. I want you to see something. And that was, and see if you can remember what it's from, but if, Jason, if you can show that clip up there. Okay, do you remember what this is from? Somebody say it in, Easter egg hunt. It's the Easter egg hunt. I mean, this was, I hadn't started yet. I'm here on Saturday, and I am watching the cars come in, but I'm watching you in the parking lot, you on the field, you at the booths, you setting out the eggs. And I'm watching the shift of people coming in and out. And it was amazing. And as I talked to Pastor Allen, I remember when he told me, he said, you know who did this? And I was thinking, okay, if it's a staff member, I am over my head right now. This, what an organization. In a few hours, the amount of people came in. In fact, the creativity to make the golden egg, to get the golden egg, what did you have to do to get the golden egg? You had to go to the gospel tent. And this is where they presented the gospel there, and everybody wanted the golden egg. The funny thing about it, you know, we do have some geese that kind of land at different places. Sometimes they put a nest right over here at this door over here. You guys know about that? Okay. Well, if you have a goose that lays, has the nest, you always have a guard goose. I don't know if that's what you call him. But it's, you know, her mate is there guarding. That day he was up by the steeple. And I had the golden egg. I remember I was going, hey, come over here and get the golden egg. You gotta come over. Then I kind of look over the steeple and you can see that goose going, what is in his hand? Anyway, side point, sorry, got off track. But anyway, as I was going through there seeing this, and as Pastor Allen was telling me who did this, he said it was the Ingersolls. And the Ingersolls, as they used to attend here, they lived, what, an hour away? And would come to church here, and now they have a church that's close to their home. But I remember the fact that this was their idea and how they worked it through. And I remember talking to Mrs. Ingersoll, and she had a file folder with her. And I said, Can I look at your notes? I go, what's that over there? Click, click. Taking pictures, she let me take copies of her notes. I was amazed that it was laymen, just church folk. They had a desire to somehow get the gospel to a lot of people. And they came up with this idea of the egg hunt that grew every year. They added different components, but I'll tell you, it took work. You know, when you look at the faith of these four, you see they're persistent, you see they're creative, but you also see they're sacrificial. Yeah, it took their time and their effort to get their friend to Jesus. But also, as they were going along and as they tore a hole in the roof, somebody was going to have to fix that. Somebody was going to have to pay for that. Somebody was going to have to take some time to get that taken care of. A faith that brings Christ's power to the world is always willing to pay the price. You know, the four, as that paralytic would come down from the roof, and Jesus says in verse 5, when he saw their faith, and then Jesus said this. In fact, if it's not already tense, if it's not already electric, if it's not already, this is amazing. Jesus just pulled the pin of the grenade and really got things going. Because then he says there in verse 5, when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there were certain scribes sitting there that were reasoning in their hearts, why did this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only? As they're dropping this man down through the roof, and as Jesus sees him, sees his friends, sees their faith, and he says to the paralytic as he's coming down, he says, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Because we know the story, that's not a shock, but for them, what do you think they were expecting Jesus to say? You're healed. Then all of a sudden he said, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. You can hear his friends going, what? His sins are going to be forgiven? You can see the religious leaders, what? What did he just say? Did he just say what I think he said? What's your notes say? Yeah, that's what I thought he said. And you see the paralytic, the paralyzed man, as he's looking at Jesus and going, what? Why would Jesus say this? You know, the interesting thing about this story, the real paralyzed people that are in this story are the religious leaders. They were sitting there. They were watching. They were criticizing. In fact, they should have been the ones that were like, as soon as he's coming down, going, hey, we got to help this guy. Let's get him down here. Hey, guys, you know, let's clear the path here. Push him back a little bit more. Let's get some space, and let's bring him in here. Here we see a healing faith from the four, but then we start to see a hindering faith from these religious leaders. In fact, take your Bible, go to Mark chapter 6. Look at Mark chapter 6, because there's times when Jesus, when he went to Nazareth, where he really grew up before he went to Capernaum, as he tried to do some miracles there, look at verses 5 and 6. And he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and healed them. And he, Jesus being God, marveled because of their unbelief. And he went round about the villages teaching. Here we see a hindering faith from these men. And you might say, well, why did Jesus just go right to the point of forgiving his sins instead of hitting him with, okay, let's get him healed? Let me give you three reasons. First of all, number one, many scholars believe, and I believe this too, that the man may have been paralyzed because of sin. This is something for him to have full healing. He needs not only be healed physically, but he needs to have Jesus' words necessary to have his sins forgiven. So maybe he's the only one that knew, but it great could possibly be and probably was because of sin. Number two, regardless of his physical condition, the greatest thing that he needed was forgiveness of sins. The greatest work of forgiveness cost Jesus his life. And here Jesus forgives his sins. And number three, it is a trap, because Jesus gives a physical miracle is verified by his moral miracle. Because once he said this, as you look there in verse 8 of chapter 2, it says, and immediately when Jesus perceived in their spirit that they had so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, why reason ye these things in your hearts? Whether it be easier to say to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, rise, take up thy bed and walk, but that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise, take up thy bed, and go thy way into thine house. And there's the word again, immediately he arose, took up his bed, went forth before them all, insomuch they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we have never seen it on this fashion. Can you imagine what goes on in verse 12? As the paralyzed man stands up, do you think he stood up and go, oh, wow, this feels pretty good. This is what walking feels like? Not bad. No. He got up, and you know he had to be going crazy. And if you got four friends that are crazy enough to break through a ceiling, can you imagine what they're doing up on top? They're like, oh, yes, this is incredible. We're not carrying your bed, by the way. You can do it yourself now. And you can see them going down the streets praising the Lord. And then you can see the religious leaders going, what? What is going on? You know, as we look at this story and as we conclude with this message, it comes to the point here that when that paralyzed man, who's no longer paralyzed, walking down the streets, jumping down the streets with his friend rejoicing, and having the four friends that make him a millionaire, the thing that's the burden that has really been lifted for him is forgiveness of sins. So let me ask you this, have you ever had your sins forgiven. When Jesus said to that paralyzed man, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Rise, take up thy bed and walk." If he would have said, "Rise, take up thy bed," and you're like, "No, I don't think I can. I can." Keep in mind that when Jesus gives forth the gospel, the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." If you've never asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins and to become your Savior, you can do that even while I'm speaking, if you truly believe. Here was a man that was changed because of what Jesus had done. So I'll give you two applications. One, we need to love the world. Not the world system, but the people that are in the world. Those that come walking through our doors, those that live across our streets, those that we work with, those that are around us, the example of these four, that they loved their friends so much that they were persistent, they were creative, and they were sacrificial in getting their friend to Jesus. What an amazing bunch of friends. And also, we need to make sure that we believe that God can heal anybody. He can forgive anybody of their sins. He can work in anybody's life. You know, Christianity is not just about America. It's about the whole world. When I read this passage and thought through this passage and the Lord is just working on my heart, it does come back to the message of, okay, what does it take to stop me? What can take place in my life that would cause me to buckle in my faith and to stop me from moving forward? And then also to keep in mind that Jesus, when we know the passage that says we need to love others as we love ourselves, right? If you believe me, say amen. Okay. In John chapter 13, in verses 34 and 35, Jesus said, "I have a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another," and they did, "as you love yourself." No, "that you love one another as I have loved you." Wow. That's huge. Here is the example that we have of those with healing faith and those with hindering faith. And I hope and pray as we look at this season that's coming upon us, that we take the example of those that we can relate to and those of the four, that our faith would be persistent, that it would be creative, and that it would be sacrificial, that we would want to be able to do what we can to see others come to know Christ as their Savior. But it really comes back to the point that we need to believe that He is, and that He's a rewarder of them that will diligently seek Him. One thing about those four that we know is they knew Jesus could and would heal. They knew that. And for us to have our faith increase, we go back to the Word of God where it says in Romans 10:17, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." Take some time to focus on this passage. Look at the verses of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, Luke chapter 5, verse 17. Even some of those passages in Mark, and realize the healing faith of those that Jesus saw their faith, but the hindering faith that even Jesus says there are times He could not do any miracles unless He laid His hand on them because He marveled at their unbelief. Wow. What a message about faith. Every head bowed and every eyes closed as we just go ahead and close our service. Father, once again, as we come on a Sunday morning after having a great time of holiday, Lord, I pray that we would help, again, step back and understand that You want us to be people of faith. And Father, I pray You help us to examine our hearts to see whether we are those that have a healing faith or those that have a hindering faith. Father, a message like this is one that we all enjoy. We love hearing the strength and the creativity and the persistence and the sacrificial faith of these four. And Father, may it be an example to us that you would look at us, and as you see our faith, as we reach out, as we love those around us and bring them to you. But Father, I can't go any farther unless we just ask you to reach hearts here. Lord, I don't know everybody in here or their spiritual condition. I'm glad they're here, but Father, you see their heart. And now, those that are sitting here, if there's someone here today that does not know Jesus as their personal Savior, if you're sitting there going, I know about the gospel. I know Jesus loves me. I have never taken that step. I encourage you to take that step today. Father, I pray you work in hearts. Help us always not to listen to a message, to check it off a list, but understand your word is given to us for us to respond. And Lord, I pray you help us to put feet to this message. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This time, Stephen's going to come lead us in a song. Let's all stand.
We'll be singing verses 1, 2, and 4 of I Am With You.
Okay, you may be seated. Just to keep in mind a couple announcements there, if you want to grab your bulletin, there are different things you want to take notice of on there. Out on the counter out there, we have these door hangers. And I'll tell you, it was just exciting last week to see how many would grab these door hangers. And I had to bring another pile out there. These right here are talking about our outdoor Christmas thing that's going to happen next Sunday. Encourage you, take these, maybe take just enough for yours, neighbors around you, and then put that on their doors, invite them in, use this as a card there. We also have a list back there if you're coming and can bring snacks, because what we want to do is not only have this outdoor Christmas thing, and we saw over 40 of our neighbors around here at the church, they came. We want to be able to have some snacks in the gym. And with that, we're going to ask you to help bring them. If you can do that, please sign up on the back and let us know that you can bring some cookies. It's just going to be a light snack. But again, that's just another bridge to help build some communications, some contacts, some conversations for the gospel. So encourage you to do that. But grab these. Also, we have these little cards as well. If you don't like how big this is, all right, you can grab one of these and use these cards as well. Tonight, as we come back, we have our prayer time at 5:15. Choir practice is going on, I think, at 4:30. Where'd Stephen go? 4:30? Okay. Ventriloquist, that's great. All right, so Stephen says 4:30, be here at 4:30, and we have prayer time at 5:15. Also, Pastor Drew is preaching tonight, so you want to make sure you come back for that and be able to enjoy that time together. Let's go ahead and stand. We'll close with a word of prayer. And if you're a guest with us and you're visiting, this is the only time you've ever been here, if you haven't been here for a long time, my wife and I would love to be able to talk to you, meet you, and have a gift for you out on the counter, out in the lobby. I'll get there eventually, as soon as we get done here, but would love to meet you. All right, let's pray. Father, we, again, are just challenged by your word. As we sit here, especially knowing that for many of us, we know Christ is our Savior, and in that, there is a burning desire to be able to share Christ with others. Father, help us to take the example of these four guys in front of us and really to look at our hearts and ask ourselves, what does it take to stop me? Am I persistent in getting the message to others? And Father, help us to be creative. Help us to have a desire to be able to get the gospel to others and then also be willing to sacrifice our time, our money, to be able to see the gospel go to others. So they might experience what Jesus said, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for our church family. Lord, I pray you bless us now as we have our Sunday school hour. Be with the teachers, with the kids, the teens, and the adults. May it be just another great time being together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.